Hi. I'm not very good with this Zoom stuff.
Hi, Sue.
Depends what she's looking at right now, you know, like we don't see all of them at once.
I guess it is. Green Bay Packers, run defense sucks. So nothing yet, huh?
I got it.
Oh, Beth is on mute too. She's on mute, so.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's great to see your faces, and I'm so grateful that you have taken time out of your afternoon to be with us today. We are all dear friends and colleagues of Dan Kirsch, and the people on this call today are family and fellow artists and organizers who have gathered across time zones and state lines to celebrate the life of this special man. My name is Jerusha Neal. I am honored to be your digital host today. This time of remembrance has been a cooperative effort. And I wanna start by giving a special thank you to Catherine Mahan and Ann Hooper and Kimberly Melton, who persevered in convening this gathering today. But a thank you as well to the parade of voices that you will hear today that are going to give some oral snapshots of Dan's transformative work in the world and his unforgettable person. Our time together is going to be about an hour. It will start with some history of Dan's groundbreaking work in Charlotte's LGBTQ community and his creative leadership in the theater communities of California and Virginia. You'll see pictures of his life and his beloved t-shirt collection paired with some of his favorite music. The bulk of our time together, though, is going to be more personal. We're going to collect memories from those who have loved Dan, and we'll share a tribute parade, remembering that Dan's legacy is not only written in the plays that he commissioned and the choirs that he founded, but also in the hearts of those who are better because he was in the world. To close our time together, you'll have an opportunity to donate to the Dan Kirsch Theater Arts Fund and see photographs of where his ashes were spread yesterday. Following the service, we'll provide a chance for some informal storytelling through small breakout rooms for anybody that's interested in that. Think of it as kind of a coffee hour, since we won't have time together in person. One of the great gifts of being Dan's friend is that he knew all the best people. So if you are on this call, let me tell you, I already count you good as gold. I first met Dan when he chose me to play a female theologian in a play that he was directing called The Busy World is Hushed. It was a little bit of typecasting, I think, on his part, as I serve as a clergywoman in real life. But over the years, Dan adopted our family. When we moved to New Jersey, he gave us some moving money. When we relocated to the South Pacific and I couldn't find a working can opener, he sent us a box of 9 of them. Even better, he sent my daughter the complete set of Rodgers and Hammerstein musicals on CD so we would have familiar melodies in our home. He was an uncle to our children and Mercy and Josiah, who are here with us today, and also a cheerleader to my husband, Wes. He was a fierce player of hearts at our kitchen table. And he was the one who always brought the pie to Thanksgiving dinner. I will miss him. But today I give thanks for him and for you and for the legacy he leaves behind. And to begin to understand that legacy, I would like to introduce you to Kimberly Melton, who worked closely with Dan in his early years in Charlotte. She was a charter member of One Voice in 1990 and served on the steering committee for the North Carolina Pride Celebration in 1994, which was a landmark event for Charlotte and for Dan.
Welcome, everyone. When I was asked to write this very challenging speech, I decided to write a letter to Dan. My dearest, dearest Dan, I miss you so very much. I don't know where to begin this letter, and I'm mad at the world. You were taken from us so incredibly quickly. I want more time with you so I can enjoy our date nights. We would eat dinner, we would play games, and always have dessert. You know, I can never go by that bakery in Plaza Midwood without thinking about you. And then of course, I have to stop and get some dessert, of course in your honor. I was thinking the other day about our adventures together. I think the first time we met was in 1990. Dee Evans invited me to sing with this new group called One Voice. We met in the gym of the old United Way building downtown, and the parking lot was really scary and dark. And I remember thinking, what have I gotten myself into? I think Dee and I were the only two women singers there. We were a small but mighty group, and it took courage to be out then. In our first concert, some of the people would only use their first names in the program because they were afraid of being outed. And remember in 1989, going with One Voice to South Carolina to sing in their Pride March because everybody in South Carolina was too afraid to go? And I remember that we were both planners and worked on so many events together. Oh, my favorite had to be the 1994 Pride March that brought to Charlotte for the first time. In 1992, you and Sue Henry and a bunch of us got together and said, I realized that there'd been a tradition for the North Carolina Pride March to be in Chapel Hill or Raleigh, Chapel Hill or Raleigh, Chapel Hill or Raleigh, all these years, but why can't it be in Charlotte? And we agreed and set about to make it so. Your and Sue's vision and leadership helped create an event that has not been duplicated since. We debated on so many things in our planning sessions, one of which was, why did it have to just be one day? When it was held in Raleigh and Chapel Hill, it was a one-day affair, you went up and back. Well, of course, Dan, you knew it could be so much more. One of the things we debated was the name of the event. It had always been called the Gay Pride Event. And I had just gotten back from the National Lesbian Conference in Atlanta and found out that the rest of the country was not using the word gay woman. They were using the term lesbian. Back then, it was the Gay Pride March, as I said. And we wanted to kind of stir things up a little bit. I suggested we put in the name lesbian, and could it please be first? So we changed the title to the North Carolina Lesbian and Gay Pride 1994 with the tagline, a weekend for lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgendered community. We wanted it to feel open for everyone. We started the weekend on Friday with Leah Delaria and comics. On Saturday, we had workshops and vendor tables and speakers. And remember Saturday night? We had the biggest dance ever held in the state of North Carolina. Oh, It was in Founders Hall, which was a brand new building. The Bank of America building, if nothing else. It was huge and grand and, well, brand new. One of my favorite memories of that weekend was standing at the top of those stairs. It was a huge grand staircase, remember? And looking down at all those people, hundreds of people.
Girl, I'm like, I need some encouragement. Thinking, I'm like, oh my goodness.
We did this. We really did this. And on Sunday,
I'm on a
March. And of course,
memorial celebration for somebody who I can't stay on.
It's no one.
I just found out about it. And I decided
that weekend. I'm so sorry. On Sunday, we had the march. And of course, we had to have it on Stonewall. And since no one was downtown on the weekend, it really didn't matter. It was no problem getting the permit. We held the ending in Marshall Park. And I remember that we were determined to get an accurate count of the number of people and handed out number bracelets to everybody. And we had over 2,000 people. Culture was so important to you. You started out Charlotte in the mid-90s to help us bring a cultural aspect to our community. And I remember while I was volunteering at Out Charlotte event, let's see, I think we were at Theater Charlotte. You sneakily surprised me and helped arrange for me to receive the Don King Community Service Award in the middle of working the event. I was shocked. But Dan, you presenting that award, it meant everything to me. Dan, if you were still here, I would say to you how grateful I am that you are in my life and will always be. You are an incredible communicator that brought people together. I miss our game nights. I miss working with you on projects. I miss all your calls. I miss our discussions on what might be next for our community. And Dan, most of all, I miss your great big hug with love. Kimberly.
Thank you, Kimberly. Catherine Mahan's connections with Dan began in the 90s when she was conducting One Voice and was running Out Charlotte. They've remained close ever since.
Over Labor Day weekend in 1994, I attended a meeting of gay and lesbian choral directors here in Charlotte. That changed my life. Dan Kirsch had produced the remarkable event almost single-handedly, and it was my first introduction to him. It was not, however, the last time that he changed my life. The North Carolina Pride celebration that Kimberly just described was a game changer in Charlotte. As gay people, we began to come out like never before. And as a community, we began to have things to celebrate. One Voice Chorus provided classy concerts that were fun and inspiring, but that was kind of the only game in town except for the bars. Then Dan founded Out Charlotte, an LGBT cultural arts organization that produced a major festival over the course of a long weekend and then sponsored smaller events throughout the year. It's embarrassing to admit this, but at the time when Dan spoke of gay poets and filmmakers and painters and plays, my honest, naive reaction was, "You mean there are gay poets and filmmakers and painters in place? Who knew?" Such was the Charlotte art scene in the 90s. Dan's vision, his tireless labor, and astounding skill set made Out Charlotte a huge success. He brought together rich and poor, Black and white, gay and straight. He made sure that bisexual and transgender artists and issues were always in scope. He created diversity training for the members of his volunteer board. So today in 2020, we would expect nothing less of a modern community organization. But this was 25 years ago in a town that was a fourth the size it is today. The fact that people like Dan were doing diversity work in the 90s is one of the reasons we're all doing diversity work today. Beyond the elegant fundraisers and the countless events, Dan created for all of us a sense of pride, a sense of being connected. He was perpetually introducing individuals and groups to one another. He convinced us we could do it. We could find the funding. We could develop the vision and carry out our plan. And he gave us excitement and confidence, even as he educated us and pushed us to think bigger. I still remember the first conversation Ann and I had with Dan about the Lesbian and Gay Community Center. It sounded like an awfully big dream to me, but we knew that if Dan was doing it, it had a good chance of making it, and we knew we would write him the biggest check we could muster. We trusted him, and sure enough, the center hosted 480 events and welcomed over 7,000 visitors in its first year. In 2001, he brought the Gill Foundation's In Community Training to town. It was a fundraising course for nonprofits that happened one night a week for 3 months. Ann and I walked into the first session and we were astounded to see every imaginable organization in the room. All the gay groups were there, but so were social service groups, child welfare groups, civic groups, every color and size and cause. Dan brought them all together, and today we still draw on the lessons that we learned in that fundraising course. When Dan began talking about the Lesbian and Gay Fund, I thought for sure he had reached too far. I didn't believe the community would generate the kind of funds he imagined or would get its act together to keep a fund going. The fund is now in its 16th year and has awarded $1.1 million in grants. Dan wasn't the only person working for LGBT visibility and equality and pride in the 90s. He was just better at it than anyone else. He had bolder visions, better ideas, more connections, more skill than anyone I have ever worked with. He could put forth the big vision and then connect all the right people to raise all the right funds and clear all the big hurdles. Then after that, he'd recruit the volunteers, write the marketing brochures and the press releases, and then pull together the report for the board to quantify all that had been accomplished. I remember being in shock when I heard Dan was leaving Charlotte. I was thrilled that we maintained our friendship through his years in San Diego and Virginia. And I won't kid you, Ann and I lobbied hard to convince him to move back to Charlotte when he was ready to leave the JCC. Not surprisingly, within months of his return to the Queen City, he'd begun raising $2.1 million for Time Out Youth and had founded the LGBT Elders. Dan's resume is chock full of eye-popping numbers, but the numbers are not Dan's legacy. The love left behind is his legacy. He left us all stronger, more informed, more confident, and more connected to one another. As a friend, I miss his creativity, his sense of what's possible, his passion for accelerating the pace of change. And I really, really miss that big laugh, that big voice, and those big hugs. The video we're about to play showcases two things: Dan's t-shirts collected over 30 years of telling the story of countless that he built or led or revived, and one of his favorite songs from the gay and lesbian choral movement. It's a lullaby that Dan and all of us wish that we had heard when we were young. I love you, Dan, and we'll miss you always.
We have cleared off the table, the leftovers saved, washed the dishes and put them away. I have told you a story and tucked you in tight at the end of your knockabout day. As the moon sets its sail to carry you to sleep over the midnight sea, well, I will sing you a song no one sang to me. May it keep you good company. You can be anybody that you want to be. You can love whomever you will. You can travel any country where your heart leads. And oh, I will love you still. You can by yourself. You can gather friends around. You can choose one special one. And the only measure of your words and your deeds will be the love you leave behind when you're gone. Some girls grow up strong and bold. Some boys are quiet and kind.
Some race on ahead, some follow behind.
Some grow in their own space and time.
Some men love men. Some raise children and some never do.
You can dream of a day never reaching the end of everything possible for you. Don't be rattled by name, taunts or games, but seek out spirits true. If you give your friends the best part of yourself, they will give the same back to you. You can be anybody that you want to be. You can love whomever you will. You can travel any country where your heart leads. And know I will love you still. You can live by yourself. You can gather friends around. You can choose one special one. And the only measure of your words and your deeds will be the love you leave behind when you're gone.
Oh, the love you
gone. Hi, I'm Patricia Lowry.
Oh, excuse me. Patricia Lowry is an accomplished playwright and professor at California State University, Long Beach. She met Dan when he was serving as the executive and artistic director of Diversionary Theater in San Diego. Dan commissioned Patty to write two plays, The Daddy Machine and Dear Harvey.
Thanks, Jerusha. I worked with Dan in San Diego when he was executive and artistic director of Diversionary Theater from 2005 to 2011. And Dan's impact on Diversionary and LGBTQ theater nationwide is significant. He did it through incredibly hard work, inclusivity, and empowering artists. After Dan's death, I spoke with actors, designers, composers, writers, and directors, all of whom told me they would not be where they are today without Dan. So after a nationwide search, Dan was hired at Diversionary, which is the third oldest LGBTQ theater in the country. And he knew the theater was struggling financially, but that's sort of his wheelhouse, wasn't it? Strengthening wobbly but worthy enterprises. But what he found when he arrived in San Diego was a theater teetering on the brink of demise. And I would say that he rolled up his sleeves and got to work, but as we all know, his proverbial sleeves were always rolled up and he was always at work, unless he was meeting somebody for coffee or dessert or breakfast or lunch. So Diversionary operated with three full-time employees, including Dan, and Dan wore many hats. He wrote grants, he strengthened the board, he curated the seasons, and he directed some of the shows. He gave the fundraising speech before every performance, and he was usually the last one leaving the theater after tidying up the lobby, but not his desk. As many of you know, he did not subscribe to the notion that a desk must be tidy. So under Dan's guidance, the theater achieved financial health, and then Dan looked around and he said, what else? What more? But he wasn't looking around for what he might want to do. He was looking for what the LGBTQ people might need, the community, the artists, the audience. In addition to producing existing work, Dan saw that we needed new plays, we needed to tell new stories, and we needed to make space for new artists. So Dan launched a program called Queer Theater Taking Center Stage to support the development of new work. We solicited scripts, we held readings of new plays and developmental workshops, and produced several world premieres. Many of those projects went on to see future productions. I was fortunate to be part of two of those projects. One day a patron approached Dan and said, "Why don't you ever do a show I can bring my daughter to?" This man and his husband had been coming to Diversionary for years, and now they wanted to see a show as a family with their four-year-old daughter. Dan searched for an LGBTQ children's show and he couldn't find one. So he commissioned composer Rami Shiromi and me to adapt a book called The Daddy Machine into a musical. Well, the audience loved it. And Dan looked around and said, what else? What more? He called a family-oriented gay travel company and got the show a gig as entertainment on board a cruise ship to the Mexican Riviera. Then he reached out to Celebration, the LGBTQ theater in LA, and they produced The Daddy Machine on their season. In spring of 2008, Dan had another idea. He was concerned that LGBTQ youth weren't taught their history in schools, and he saw that the legacy of Harvey Milk might be lost. I didn't know much about Harvey at the time, so when Dan offered me a commission to write a tribute play about Harvey Milk, I hesitated. But when Dan Kirsch had an idea that involved you, well, many of you know how that goes. A year later, Dear Harvey, directed by Dan, with music by a young composer named Thomas Hodges, premiered at Diversionary Theater. The show was a hit. Dan said, what else? He brought the show to New York, where it won an award for Best Ensemble at the New York Fringe Festival. What else? He directed a celebrity reading of the play when Harvey Milk was inducted to the California Hall of Fame. Dear Harvey has since had over 30 productions nationwide, including three this year alone. Most of those are in colleges where the young people Dan envisioned are learning about their history. Dan loved theater. He gave himself completely to every moment of the work. I've seen him land a multi-year grant from a major funder one moment, then sit down to sew sequins on a costume for an opening night. Today, Diversionary Theater is thriving. They continue to solicit and produce new LGBTQ plays. Many of you know that Dan's true legacy is the incredible, unconditional love that he gave to his friends. But I wanted you to know that his legacy also includes the plays, the musicals, and the artists that he championed.
Thank you, Patty. Jeff Danek is the executive director of the Pozzuz Jewish Community Center of Northern Virginia. When Dan was ready to leave San Diego, Jeff hired him to the new post of cultural arts director at the center in Fairfax.
Thank you, Jerusha. Before I start, I'm still reeling from the slideshow with the music, Everything's Possible, because at our farewell event for Dan, he sang that, sang an excerpt from that, and I could hear his voice streaming through today. My first priority when I became executive director of the JCC in Northern Virginia in 2011 was to create a new cultural arts department and to hire a cultural arts director. I needed a visionary, an entrepreneur, a community builder, and mostly I needed a thought partner. We had a national search, and the job requirements included things like excellent interpersonal skills to inspire cooperation, dedication from key volunteers, staff, and community patrons. We were looking for an energizer, an arts builder. We need somebody with a quick wit and a strong sense of humor. And knowledge and experience in Jewish arts and culture was also on the list. In that regard, Dan was not our typical applicant. He wrote a brilliant cover letter, and with the name Kirsch and his Jewish Yiddish theater accent, thought maybe he could pass for Jewish, but he was awfully tall and thin to be part of our traditional community. But he made his adjustments and he fit in beautifully. Something set him apart from everybody in that candidate pool. His warmth, his humor, his hunger to learn, but everything he did was with confidence and humility. He won everybody over. It was a very easy decision to hire Dan. When I first moved to Virginia, I moved ahead of my family. And so when I hired Dan, I was in an empty house, and Dan was looking for a place to live. So initially he came and lived with me in his first several months. And so we were always working, dreaming, planning, eating takeout, or sometimes Dan would cook, but whenever he cooked, it was always a whole roasted chicken, his traditional dish. We'd work on his Yiddish, his Hebrew. He's the best charades player I've ever seen. He's legendary with my two girls. And we became colleagues, collaborators, dear friends, but really more like family. We worked together for about 4.5 years, but our friendship would go on to live forever. But in those 4.5 years, we accomplished a tremendous amount of things. We established and grew the Cultural Arts Department at the JCC. We elevated the existing programs we had for film, for dance and visual arts, including bringing the Egg exhibit to the Bodson Art Gallery. And we established new programs in music, including several new cabaret performances, including a tribute to Leonard Cohen, a world premiere of Just Between Us featuring Marilyn Hausfeld, a member of our community, and several partnerships with Signature Theater and their actors. We brought the Gay Men's Chorus of Washington, D.C. to the JCC in Virginia, and we hosted several a cappella groups, including the Maccabees 613 and the winner of the college Jewish a cappella competition. And in theater, he created a summer camp for us for theater artists called Camp Amanut. He helped launch the Jewish Plays Project, which we have done continuously for the last 7 years. And my biggest thrill was when Dan convinced me to commission a local playwright named Helen Pafumi to write a play called Red or Blood. We worked with Helen on script development, conducted multiple readings. We eventually entered into the Jewish Plays Project, which won first place that year on the national competition. And then we co-produced the world premiere with Helen at her theater, the Hub Theater, and subsequently went to New York. Dan was driven to create excellent work and bring it to life, starting with his curtain speeches, where he would get up before the show and get the audience energized. He was absolutely committed to creating and nurturing community. He gave great hugs, as you've all heard. He had a great laugh, and he also had great hair, something I was always a bit jealous of. He was admired, respected, and beloved by everybody he touched. At the end of every year, Dan and I would review our accomplishments and our challenges and revisit our goals. Every year, we would talk about our plans and dreams for the future. Every year, I would try to get Dan to commit long-term, or at least for the next 3 to 5 years. And every year, I would get the same answer. "I can promise you one more year," he would say. Dan didn't like to make long-term commitments, at least not to me. He would give us one more year, every year, one more year, until 2016, when he said, "It's time for me to go home to Charlotte." One more year. 525,600 minutes, 525,000 journeys to plan, 525,600 minutes. How do you measure a life of our dear friend, Dan? Thank you.
525,600 minutes. 525,000 moments so dear. 525,600 minutes. How do you measure a year? In daylights, in sunsets, in midnights, in cups of coffee, in inches, in miles, in laughter, in strife. In 525,600 minutes. How do you measure a year in the life?
Six hundred minutes. 525,000 to plan. 525,600 minutes. How do you measure the life of a woman or a man?
In truth that he learned, or in times that he cried, or the bridges he burned, or the way that she died.
It's time now to sing out. But the story never ends. Let's celebrate, remember a year in the life of friends.
Thank you. One of the challenges of putting together a celebration like this is that Dan knew hundreds of people, and so many were ready to speak about his impact on their lives and their work. In this next portion of our remembrance, we've gathered together just a few of those voices, providing a sort of tribute parade of brief glimpses into why Dan was so loved. We'll begin by hearing from Dan's three sisters. And first up is his youngest sister, Kathy.
Thank you, Jerusha. Well, as she said, I am Dan's sister, Kathy. I'm the baby sister. Dan was my oldest brother. We had a special bond from the beginning because I was told the story about when I was born, that Dan was so excited that he was having another baby sister. He told all the neighbors and called everyone. So my name was already made up. My name was Kathy K. Kirsch, and he told everyone, so they didn't have a chance to change my name. As the years went by, he always made time for me when he came back for a visit. I remember going to visit him in New York City, and I thought that he lived in the coolest place ever. He always followed his dreams, and I thought he was the coolest big brother for doing that. As I grew up, I loved to sing. And I was in musicals in high school, as was Dan. I played a leading role as Amy Spadigue in Where's Charlie? And when Dan was in high school, he played Charlie in the play. So we were both pretty proud of that. And as usual, Dan was always there, and he made it back for my opening night. I visited him in many places, in New Bedford, in Charlotte, and in Virginia. And I always admired him for going new places and trying new things. He was real. He was patient. He was kind. He was gentle and I loved his infectious laugh, and I've heard that from many of you, you know what that is. He loved his ice cream and obviously his desserts. And he must have gotten that from my dad, because I know that my dad loved ice cream as well. So I hope they're both enjoying some ice cream. I just wish I could enjoy some ice cream again with Dan. Thank you all for putting this together. I love you, Dan.
Thank you, Kathy. Beth, you're next.
How am I supposed to follow that one? So I am, Dan again was my oldest brother. I was the middle child of the family. So, but Dan got me. So it was, he was a great older brother who was very humble and kind. I remember attending many of his plays that he loved doing, and he was very, very talented. I didn't have that talent, but I enjoyed watching him. As he moved around the country to pursue his theater, his nonprofit work, and LGBT community work, I became more interested in his efforts. We did share the art of fundraising together, because that's what I do for a profession, and he would always joke and say, hey, when one of your big donors has extra money, send it my way. You could help my efforts. Didn't happen, but I tried. I got to visit him several times in Charlotte, in Wilmington, in San Diego, and we actually attended one of his plays at the Diversionary Theater in San Diego. I can't remember the name of it now, but we took the kids along and they loved it. We didn't see each other very often, but we stayed in touch and we talked every few months to catch up. He was always a good listener, had good advice, and loved to hear what was happening with me and my family. I miss those calls, as they always gave me a sense of peace that he was doing well and accomplishing great things. Little did I know the impact that he had on so many people and so many lives. I hope that we can all carry on his legacy of kindness and help others out. He would always end the conversation with me, "Be good to yourself, little sis." So, big brother, be good to yourself, and thank you for making the world a better place and for being my big brother. I love you.
Thank you, Beth. And now, Sister Sue.
Nope. That's not Sister Sue.
No, sorry. It's Wolf. The wrong Sue. Sorry.
Sue Wolf.
Sue Wolf. Sue Wolf, are you on the roster under a different name?
She is. She's S. Wolf. I found her now, though.
Okay, very good.
Good. Thank you, Mercy.
Would you mind unmuting? We can't hear you. Sorry.
Susie, you need to unmute.
Okay. Does that do it?
Yes, that's good.
Okay. So, sorry about that. I'm the oldest sister, and I don't know computers very well. There you go. But anyway, I want to bring back some memories of Dan in the early years. In the early years, Dan was our go-to person, the one that we always looked up to, not just because he was the tallest, and he was always the tallest, but because he was the strongest. He was the oldest of five siblings, Danny, Susie, Tommy, Bethy, and Kathy, and we all lived in a small rural farmhouse in Wisconsin. He had a lot of responsibilities watching over the rest of us and helping wherever he was needed. Early on, Dan was a star in anywhere from the tap dance classes that we took together and on through his theater life. He loved reading, music, drama, He began performing in theater and chorus groups in the 4-H groups, which were in middle school, and then on to high school, where there was always a perfect play for him to participate in or perform. Dan was the first to get out. He was off to technical college, performing and perfecting his culinary skills. And then he moved to New York, of all places. I couldn't fathom that. He was only a year older than me, but here he was going off to New York at age 20. But he moved so far away, but back then the need was great for him to get out and come out and continue doing what he loved. I miss those little things that we did together, making snowmen and ice skating in on the barnyard pond and performing on stage with him in the tap dance class, and missing those early mornings that we sat in front of the register, the heat register, to warm up, and the talks we had over the years. Dan was our fearless, gentle giant, looking out for us as we grew, protecting us as only he could. I wish there was more time for visits and talks and laughters and cheers. To my big bro, a great brother, strong, talented, humble leader, until we meet again. Loves and hugs.
Thank you all for sharing about Dan's childhood with us. Next, we hear from Shelley Remley, who worked in community theater with Dan in the 80s.
Hello, everyone. I have the honor of sharing some thoughts with you today on behalf of the Bloomsburg Theater Ensemble and Dan's many friends and colleagues from Bloomsburg, Pennsylvania. I first met Dan in the mid-1980s when I was a volunteer and board member for the Bloomsburg Theater Ensemble, or BTE, and Dan was BTE's administrative director. While learning from Dan the importance of pairing optimism with the hard work of managing a nonprofit professional theater company, he and I became friends. One thing that Dan and I shared was a birthday. Almost, Dan was 1 day older than me. I mention that because most years, over 3 decades, Dan reached out with birthday greetings to me before I did the same for him, even though his birthday was 1 day earlier. Whether he was in California, North Carolina, or Virginia, he was faithful at staying in touch. Dan was BTE's third administrative director, serving almost 3 years from 1985 through 1987. And Dan embraced and elevated BTE's model of an artist-empowered theater collective. His boundless energy, tireless advocacy, and buoyant spirits sustained us through some challenging financial times. Dan was a natural in bringing people together of all perspectives and backgrounds. And then in 1989, Dan returned to BTE, this time as a guest director for one of our few forays into musical theater company. Realizing that the rights were prohibitive for BTE, Dan contacted Sondheim directly, making it possible for us to tackle something outside of our grasp. Dan spent the rest of his life helping others reach beyond their grasp. Proud to say the BTE continues today, now in its 42nd season. Thank you, Dan. We love and remember you.
When Dan left Pennsylvania, he moved to Charlotte. One of his first projects in his new home was to launch One Voice, Charlotte's first gay and lesbian chorus. John Quillen was there at the beginning and went on to conduct the group for more than a decade.
Hi, you know, my name is John Quillen, and it's no understatement to say that meeting Dan Kirsch changed my life. When we met in 1989, he just arrived from Philadelphia, where he had been a participant in the Philadelphia Gay Men's Chorus, and Charlotte didn't have any such thing. Dan, who was actually trained as a chef, but who grew up to be an instigator, decided to start one. So together he, the first artistic director, Jan McCoy, and I pulled a group together 31 years ago last night, Halloween 1989, in the Charlotte Shakespeare office. And one voice was born. Our first rehearsal was the following January. In the 30 years since that night, I think maybe 1,000 singers have participated in that ensemble. And that chance meeting in 1989 launched me on a career of choral conducting that I'm lucky enough to continue in. Dan knew then what I and so many other singers would discover, that our music changes hearts, changes minds, changes lives, it changes the world. Thanks, Dan, for the harmonies that have accompanied my life.
One of Dan's many collaborators in the early 90s was Pam Pompei.
Hi. Not this season. It's a letter to Dan. Dear Dan, sometimes the smallest disappointments in a relationship can overshadow the biggest accomplishments in a relationship. What seems small and forgivable can become an anchor of unforgiving sadness when you lose someone unexpectedly. I want to take this time to say I'm sorry. I'm sorry I forgot to add that special community event to my calendar. I'm sorry that I let you down. I hope time would heal that tiff and that we would gather once again at Dunkin' Donuts or Baskin Robbins or McDonald's or Starbucks, where we would meet to check in on each other and to support each other. Not this season. This season, I will barely be able to look at a photo of your mischievous, handsome smile. This season, I won't be able to hear your rapid thoughts, your suggestions and ideas about community involvement, the arts, fundraising, and philanthropy. This season, we won't share our annual personal progress report and how we plan to be less emotional elusive in the coming season. This season and all the seasons to come, I'll draw on my fondest memories of you and I will group them together to tell a story of two people from vastly different backgrounds who became near and dear comrades under the rainbow flag. Not adding that event to my calendar caused me to miss an opportunity to see my friend again. So in our tradition, I owe you two favors. One today, because you know how I hate sharing my feelings and saying goodbye. The second favor I'll reserve for a time in the future when I can honor you and your legacy and my friendship properly. And how will you do that, Pam Pompei, you ask? Don't worry, Dan Kirsch, I say. I'm sure you will let me know, just like you always let me know. Until then, rest peacefully and know that you will be missed.
Devlin McNeil worked with Dan to incorporate visual arts into the Out Charlotte programming and was a major supporter of the first ever Lesbian and Gay Community Center in Charlotte. Due to a family commitment, she's unable to join us today, but I'm pleased to read this tribute from Devlin. She writes, I met Dan more than 15 years ago as he was wrapping up his time at Out Charlotte and conceiving of the Charlotte Lesbian and Gay Community Center. He cast the vision to Amy and me in a gallery in NODA, and we immediately signed up for the ride. I volunteered with Dan and many others in cleaning up that large, dusty space on Central Avenue where the community center first lived. I worked with him as the center got up and running, and for several years managed the large community room that also served as a gallery to highlight LGBTQ+ artists. We worked together on the yearly art auction that served as a fundraiser for the community center. I volunteered there as long as Dan was there. He inspired service. What I didn't realize over 15 years ago was a friendship with Dan was a friendship for life. Some friends have seasons and come and go in and out of your life. With Dan, regardless of where he went around the country, he remained a dear friend. The kind of friend you would welcome into your home after not seeing each other for several years and picking up right where you left off. I was always amused when Dan wanted to meet for coffee when he didn't get out of bed until 10 a.m. or later. When I reflect on the Charlotte LGBTQ plus community, I see Dan everywhere. Dan was fearless, in my opinion, never afraid to ask for anything, never a self-serving ask, but an ask because he saw something that would advance the greater community. 15 years ago, Dan taught me what it means to be a philanthropist, one who makes an active effort to promote human welfare, as defined by Merriam-Webster. I miss him. I will continue to miss him. I miss his tremendous hugs and big laugh, and more than a dozen times I've wondered how he would all be bringing all of us together in the midst of a global pandemic. Thank you, Devlin. Tom Warshauer became friends with Dan during his Out Charlotte days in the 90s. He's going to share a bit about their relationship, as well as some reflections that came to him after seeing a reading of Dear Harvey produced by Breakthrough Theater Workshop, which included a tribute to Dan.
Well, Dan and I got to know each other decades ago as he worked with Out Charlotte in the community center. And we shared a passion for inclusion and celebrating difference. And we knew of the struggles so many LGBT organizations had and still have raising funds to sustain their operations. When he heard there was a national funding consortium offering communities $100,000 if they would establish a fund for their local community foundation, he encouraged a number of us to work together to apply. We met with the Foundation for the Carolinas and each member of their board, because Dan knew how we had to go about it, and helped them change the employee non-discrimination policies to include sexual orientation and gender identity way before so many were doing that, which enabled us to apply, and then we received the grant. Now we're decade old and having given away over $1 million, as you heard earlier, the Charlotte Lesbian and Gay Fund is one of the country's leaders in local LGBT philanthropy. Dan and I remained close in the years after he moved from Charlotte. When he returned to visit the Queen City, a community he never fully left, he stayed with Andy and I. He wasn't an early riser, but he did, in the times that he was up, find out everything that was going on in our community and all that was happening in the LGBT community in Charlotte. And then later on in the evenings, I would get to find out what was going on in my own city. Dan accepted and loved and embraced and rejoiced in all of us and worked to be sure that we were all at the table for the Feast of Life. Dan also exposed me to the fullness of the impact of Harvey Milk's life. When I was listening to the San Diego Memorial for Dan that included a reading of Harvey Milk, I realized even more how they were kindred spirits. Dan was our Harvey Milk. That was probably part of the reason Dan wanted Harvey's story told. Dan Harvey's spectacular and tragic life really resonated with him. They didn't care about money, they cared about us. They were for inclusion of all types of people, LGBT and non-LGBT. He was proud to be gay, but he fought for the inclusion of everyone, the elderly, the immigrant, people of color, trans, non-gender non-conforming, all the others. They knew we were all our best when all of us were included. That expanding the acceptance of others allows us to accept the fullness of ourselves. I think I heard from Harvey's play something that said like this: you are different. The fact that you are different makes you rare. And that rareness is what the world needs. Our differences are what the world needs now. Dan wanted everyone's story to be told and celebrated. He lived his life as he saw Harvey Milk live his. I see Dan and Harvey standing together and laughing together. In my mind, Dan was our Harvey, loved and honored as a man who put others first, relishing in the beauty of authentic lives lived openly and joyfully. Dan helped me see that and helped me live to be a better, fuller, more joyful human. Dear Dan, you are there for all of us as we are here today to celebrate you.
Thank you, Tom. When Dan returned to Charlotte after living in Virginia, he launched the Charlotte LGBT Elders. Cindy Hostetler worked with Dan on that project.
Hi, I'm one of the co-chairs of the Charlotte LGBTQ Elders Group. Dan was a pioneer in his leadership, and his loss continues to be felt across our organization. The Charlotte LGBTQ Elders provides education, advocacy, and the creation of inclusive engagement opportunities to create social networks and make a positive impact for older adults in our community. Dan provided courageous leadership that continues to herald support and visibility for all LGBTQ people living in Charlotte. Our mission is to believe in the quality of life, equity, and affirmation for all, a foundation that Dan modeled daily that will serve as inspiration for our future. We love and miss you, Dan, Charlotte LGBTQ Elders Steering Committee and members.
Thank you. Josh Burford is the director and lead archivist of the Invisible Histories Project, a repository of the history of LGBTQ life across the Southeast. Currently in Alabama, Josh previously lived in Charlotte and started the LGBT Oral History Project while he was a professor at UNCC.
So in October 2012, I moved to Charlotte from Alabama with lots of radical ideas about what I thought should be happening in Charlotte, including a community-based archiving project that I just assumed everyone would be on board for immediately. I went to the LGBT Community Center my first week in Charlotte, speaking to a large group of people. I laid out my plan, said what I wanted to do, and an older member of the group turned to me and said, "So, you're the new Dan Kirsch?" At that point, I didn't even know who Dan was. Had no idea there was a legacy there to which I could pick up. But Dan was a student of history, and he understood the importance of LGBTQ history to people in our community. His donation of his early records to Duke University shows that he hoped others could learn from both his successes and his mistakes. Dan's support of the collections that I worked on while in Charlotte allowed me to connect with so many people, and his participation in the project showed that there were pieces of the story held in multiple places by so many different people. To get that story right, we need everyone to help us tell it and not just a select few at the top. Dan understood that to create a better future for ourselves, we must understand our past. I am delighted that Dan's remaining records will be included in the King Henry Brockington collections at UNC Charlotte. And I would encourage everyone that's here today, if you have memories of Dan that you want to share to be included, to please reach out, and we would love to include those materials as well. I personally can't thank Dan enough for his support of my work to preserve the Queer South. And I can promise, as both a member of the community, as an archivist and a historian, to his friends and family that his legacy will not be forgotten, and that we will work hard to keep imagining the future that he hoped that we could together create.
Thank you, Josh. Dan was always actively engaged in Charlotte's community theater scene, where Dennis Delamar is among the local legends.
You did not say legend. Hey, everybody. Friends with Dan for decades. I always knew one of our biggest connections was the theater and the arts. He adored it. As an audience member, as a participant, was so supportive of Charlotte Productions. I enjoyed our conversations, especially of LGBTQ shows we had seen in New York, but also here. I was involved with making some of those happen. Shows we were involved with in our past, our present. If you were a performer or a director, like I have been, seeing his loving face after a show and getting his hug and words of approval had touching significance for any of us artists. And one of the times Dan was not living in Charlotte, he was a part of Northern Virginia's Jewish Community Center, where he was active with the National Jewish Play Festival. With that experience, and it's been mentioned here earlier, he came back to Charlotte to bring the festival to us at the Levine JCC. He produced it here its first year. The artistic director there, Susan Gundershine, said he taught her how to make it happen. Said he basically held her hand through the experience and got them on the path for future successful festivals. She tells a story, though, that I enjoy about some chairs. Some of you may relate to this. It was opening night of the first big show, the winner of the festival. And Dan insisted when they set up the room that they had only 100 chairs, no more. Must look cozy and intimate and full. She knew they had oversold and would need more chairs, but he was adamant, only 100, that magic number. When the space filled up and the people kept coming and they hauled in stacks of chairs, they eyed each other smiling, agreeing that they both were right. There was a fantastic stubborn streak there in Dan, but it was always dressed with a smile. An experience I got to be a part of that meant so much to Dan was bringing the documentary style play to Charlotte in reader's stage form, Dear Harvey, a historic production close to his heart about the life and death of Harvey Milk, one of our greatest gay activists. Tom mentioned this so beautifully, and public office holders who was murdered. We actors here in Charlotte felt honored to be a part of it, inspired by Dan and his enthusiasm for the story, the play he championed from the start with awesome writer Tricia Lowry, who I loved seeing on here earlier, and of course its valuable message to us all, especially to our community. Talkbacks were incredible, where the audience members engaged with us after each performance, all by Dan's design, of course. It was a rewarding experience for us all, and I'm a retired teacher and I love visuals, but this is our cast all surrounding our beloved Dan after a rehearsal of Dear Harvey here in Charlotte. Check out the long hair that he loved, one of his signatures that I'm going to mention in a second. Finally, knowing how much Dan loved theater, I was so thrilled when he ventured back on the stage after many years of not acting. I teased him when I heard, like Norma Desmond, making not a comeback, but a return. It wasn't that long ago, just 2 years ago, October of 2018 at Theater Charlotte. The show was the Philadelphia Story set in the 1930s, and it got him to cut his long hair that he had become so fond of. I talked with Tanya Bloodsworth, his director, her words. He was every bit the elder statesman during the run. Having his calm, go with the flow energy on set was such a gift with so many young actors in need of lots of attention. Dan needed almost none. He took notes and suggestions and turned them into beautiful comedic performance. She said, on the days when I thought I'd pull my hair out trying to get something out of the youngsters, he always seemed to be there with simple words of encouragement and support. We know those words, don't we? I do. She added, I feel so lucky to have been able to work with him and honored that he chose this show to return to the stage. I got a picture, another picture for it. This is so not Dan. He was acting. Look at this stern face. He was Uncle Willie in the show. And then this one interacting. Okay. I saw his performance as Uncle Willie, fantastic, distinguished, handsome, and quite funny. Norma Desmond couldn't have done any better. Like you, I feel so lucky he was a part of my life, of all our lives, on stage, off stage, and in all those times he lovingly spent with us. This gentle and wise man who made good things happen is forever in our hearts. Such a pleasure to be able to talk on his behalf. I miss my dear friend. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dennis. Thomas Hodges is a musical artist and composer whose works include the score for Dear Harvey.
Thank you for having me speak tonight. Dan taught me more than anyone the power of my gay pride and what that really meant, I think. I met Dan when I was 18, and back then I had no gay role models at all. He was the first gay man I ever met that was out that wasn't my age, and he instantly became a mentor to me without hesitation. And with each passing day, I'm realizing more and more of what I truly owe to this incredible man. Every day, the lessons he taught me push me to be better, kinder, and more generous. And I think we all know those lessons. Dan gave me countless opportunities. He was, he gave me jobs, my first commission, my second commission, my entire professional life. I can connect to my time with Dan. The first year I moved to New York, he asked me how I was doing, and I was scared. I was a young kid in New York, and he gave me a job. He was in Fairfax, Virginia then, music directing and bringing together a musical review. He had so much trust in me. He trusted me before I trusted myself. He would come to New York and insist on introducing me to someone new, constantly. And I was always so grateful for that. I could spend a lot of time talking about how Dan supported my artistic endeavors, but I think I want to talk about a couple smaller moments, which are big moments. He always would ask me questions about my life. And at first, I didn't ask many of him. I noticed this early on. I don't know if it was shyness or I don't know. But I always answered most of the questions. It took me a couple years to start asking him questions. His answers were often short, but occasionally he would elaborate and tell me a story from his past or his present. And I hold those moments close to me today. Whether it was over a slice of cake, which it often was, he insisted on us grabbing after dinner or during a car ride or over a card game. Each day I feel Dan's perspective on art and his support for artists guiding me in my choices. I miss him. I find myself thinking of calling or emailing him, but each time that happens, I smile too. He was and will always be a great mentor to me. Thank you so much.
Thomas, thank you. Ann Hooper served on the board of directors for Out Charlotte, shared Dan's knack for fundraising, and was his very good friend.
Thank you. We know that Dan appreciated the people in his life almost as much as his favorite coffee ice cream with warm Hershey's chocolate syrup on top. He graciously thanked people for their thoughts, their ideas, and their contributions. But sometimes he wanted to say a little bit more. I found this card near the top of his work papers when we were sorting out his belongings after he passed. There is no way to know who he planned to send this to or how long he actually had this card. Dan's intention could have been to send it to any of you on this screen. As I read this card, I hope you will each know that it could have been picked out, especially for you. The best friends are fellow travelers on the road of life. The best friends change and grow with each other and learn through one another's experiences and lessons. The best friends can share the most insignificant and the most shining parts of themselves with the same degree of joy and openness. The best friends are friends for a lifetime, like you and me.
Thank you, Ian. There are no words that can sum up a life that has been so generously lived, but I am deeply grateful for all of you who have witnessed today to Dan's heart and skill and legacy. Thank you. I'd like to turn the floor over now back to Anne, who's going to share with us a little bit about how we might make a contribution to the Dan Kirsch Theater Arts Fund.
Dan's passion for making the world a better place was always so contagious. We spent many hours brainstorming ideas for causes, events, and fundraisers, and Dan was always looking for a new idea that would be fun and engaging, even as it called attention to some important message or group. And there always seemed to be a running theme to all of this talk, theater, and performance. In recognition of Dan's first love, the theater, we've created the Dan Kirsch Theater Arts Fund to provide grants to the people that Dan would want to help most. Budding playwrights creating new works, student performers, composers of new music for theater or choral groups, even one man or one woman shows. We are asking those of you who would like to remember Dan with a memorial gift to help us by sending your contribution to the Lesbian and Gay Fund in care of the Foundation for the Carolinas, making sure to indicate the Dan Kirsch Fund on your check or note it with your online gift. The link for online gifts has been dropped into the chat on this call, and it can also be found on Dan's Facebook page. I can think of no better way that we as a community can honor Dan to support the ongoing development of the arts, which were his passion. We hope when this pandemic is over that we can all gather together, be together, and honor the first grant recipient from the Dan Kirsch Theater Arts Fund. So stay tuned. We will be together someday. And thank you in advance for your generous remembrance to the Theater Fund.
So thank you so much to all of you who have been here today. It's very touching to know how much Dan meant to all of us. We have one last video for you. And before we go to it, I just want to say Kimberly Melton has put these videos together and done a brilliant job. The music you're going to hear is the San Francisco Gay Men's Chorus singing a song entitled Never Ever. The lyrics remind us to take each moment as a gift and to give back. We couldn't imagine a more fitting tribute to Dan. But I want to say first, there's a bit for you to know about the place where we scattered his ashes. Dan wanted to be put to rest in the North Carolina mountains that he loved. The spot his friends chose is a place he had visited and a place with a long history of connection to the LGBT community. For the last 60 years, progressive friends, including gay men, lesbians, and their straight friends, have been spending the summers in a place called Linville Gorge, adjacent to Ginger Cake Acres. Four homes particularly formed a community with Rob Williams and Warren Womble, Nancy Duncan and Helen Kappelman, Helen Stroop, and George Daly. They were the gays and lesbians, artists, educators, musicians, and civil rights attorneys, and their guests included dancers, designers, actors, pilots, and people in all sorts of careers, but particularly the performing arts. This was a place they could all be themselves. Some of the original LGBT elders have now passed on, but it continues to be a place for people from all walks, stewarded now by Chuck Barger and his family and by Tom Warshauer and Andy Dews, good friends of Dan's. All these generations have hiked regularly to an overlook called Sitting Bear with a spectacular view of Linville Gorge, the Grand Canyon of the East, and the outcroppings of Table Rock and Hawksbill. Sitting on these rocks with Charlotte, sometimes visible in the far, far distance, has always been the highlight of any trip of this enclave. Dan rests here now, where people journey to witness the beauty of the Blue Ridge Mountains and reconnect to nature themselves. It is a special place for everyone, especially the LGBT community, made more special now by the presence of Dan. Yesterday, a small group of us, Kimberly, Tom, Andy, Chuck, Ann, and I, had the honor of scattering Dan's ashes in the North Carolina mountains. We want to play this video for you now. While that's coming up, I'll add my thanks to Mercy Neal, who has done the logistics for us today.
Kimberly, you had mentioned you wanted to share this video. Would you like me to just go ahead and share the version I have? I'm going to just do that.
Okay, thank you, Mercy.
Oh, thank you, Mercy. I'm sorry.
Would you like to share it or should I?
Why don't you go ahead?
All right.
One minute. No, I've got it. Can you see that?
Not yet.
Okay.
We're grateful for technologically gifted friends.
I'll just... I'll just go ahead and share it here.
Okay.
Let people know that you can actually see these videos again if you go to YouTube and you search Visual Story Media or Dan Kirsch. You can see them. You can also see them on Dan's Facebook page. Dan had a gift for seeing the potential and significance in a work of art. When he met Phil Burns, he discovered that Phil was managing his chronic pain with a simple act of artistic resistance. He drew one egg every day. Dan didn't just see this as a single person doing a small thing. He saw it as a parable for how art could heal and he decided that he would keep Phil Burns's art alive, curating it and sharing it with the world. I wanted to show you, just as we close today, this piece. This is the piece that Dan gave me. And it speaks to me of the seeds we plant and trees that they leave behind. It's been a challenging 4 years for our nation and for those in the LGBTQ community. And Dan would want to make sure that you vote on Tuesday, but more than that, he would want to make sure that you keep creating, you keep resisting, you keep healing with art, and you keep loving each other well, planting seeds and nurturing forests. Thank you so much for being here with us today. Our official time of remembrance is over, but in just a moment,